Hello and welcome. We are back, beaten but not defeated. One more episode of Communalism Combat Special Interaction, this time with noted vocalist, composer and musician Shubha Mudgal. Shubha ji is known not just for her incredible voice and singing, but as a composer, a voice for the creative rights of artists, and using technology with partner Anish Pradhan, also archiving and documenting the rich history of Hindustani classical music. Last but not the least, Shubha ji has also been a voice of resistance to forces of authoritarianism, violence and bigotry. Welcome Shubha ji on our show.
Call me Shubha ji, you have to drop the G.
Okay, then Shubha.
Please.
Shubha, you were born in Allahabad into a family of academics who were always steeped in the Hindustani classical tradition. How was it growing up in Allahabad? What do you still have of that city?
Well, you know, it was not really a background where my parents were not only lovers of Hindustani music, but generally they were really passionate about the arts and in particular about music and poetry. And so I grew up in this home surrounded by books and, sort of conversations about English literature as well as about Urdu literature and about the iconic singers who visited and performed occasionally in Allahabad. And I also grew up around people who had been involved. I mean, their work was not only a profession, but they were passionate about their work and they were committed to various ideologies. And diverse ideologies. So it wasn't as if everybody belonged to one school of thought. So I grew up in this home which gave me many opportunities to explore several kinds of art forms. And I think my parents never really stopped me from exploring all of that. In fact, they actively encouraged me and my sister, my only sibling, to really, taste and take delight in all the wonderful, flavors that art and brings to your life and enriches. That's how we grew up.
You did a lot of Kathak in the beginning.
Yes, I grew up, since I was four, I started learning how to dance and loved dressing up and, whirling around and doing chakkars and everything. And it was through that journey that my mother suggested that one part of Kathak involves singing as well. And she felt it was a good idea for me to get this interdisciplinary, opportunity to learn vocal music as well. And of course, I was exposed to a lot of very good vocal music and instrumental music, primarily Hindustani classical because it was the north of India and that's what was available there. I had listened to a lot of music but not really had the kind of formal talim that is required for Hindustani classical music. And then once my mother encouraged me to start learning vocal music, it was just the journey sort of sped up. And I made I think she helped me understand that this is what I love doing and this is what I should be doing and making a commitment to studying music for the rest of my life.
That's a lovely way of putting it. So you say you also had a plethora of gurus from whom you've learned, and today you spend much of your time in training young people.
Yes.
So Shubha gives as much as she got, or?
Well, I must tell you that, of course, I learned in the institutional way also, where you go to university and enroll for a course and pay your tuition fee, etc. But a lot of my learning came from gurus who really made me a part of their extended family. And I never paid any fee to them. They never charged a fee. In fact, their homes became second home for me. Pandit Jitendra Abhisheki in Pune, for example, I would go and live in his house. And not only he, but his wife and his family were, it's very generous to allow a stranger to come into your home and spend a month there learning and actually find out what they like to eat, what they want. I think it's an act of great generosity, not only on the part of the guru, but his spouse as well and his family as well. And I remain eternally grateful for that opportunity. And I feel the only way, without making a hullabaloo about it, the only way I feel I can just thank them is to make my very small, crowded home available for people who wish to come and learn from me.
And there are many who'd want to.
Yes, there are several who come, and of course.
How do you choose? How do you So many people must be approaching you.
Well, I think the only thing that I look for is some sense of the student who would like to make a commitment to music. I don't demand anything else. Many of my students have, come back to me after 6-7 years and said, no, you know, this is not for us. They've become homemakers, but they remain in touch. I'm deeply involved in their lives. I receive a lot of love and, you know, affection from them, and I feel, you know, very close to them. But I don't really wait, you know, and do a DNA testing and say, you know, this is the student who will, you know. I just say, okay, here is what I can give you. And I'm very brutally honest about the fact that I travel a lot. I will not be available at all times. They will need to come to me when I have the time. And anybody who's willing to brave that is welcome.
You say that, the time that you've given to explore the boundaries of your own talent, which is a constant journey, it's a lifetime journey. You're not concentrating only on that. A lot of your time with your partner is also spent on archiving and documenting this huge tradition of Hindustani music, whether it's just through _records.com or sangeetkosh.net, where you try and use technology. You always believe that young people should be involved in this. So, I mean, you also fought for the creative rights of artists. So, what all of this makes up?
You know, what was happening for the last, let's say, 20 years or so, both Anish and I were traveling a lot for our own concerts, and we would hear wonderful musicians, meet very, you know, people with great wisdom and scholarship. And yet when you looked for their books, when you looked for their music, it was very difficult to find it. Sometimes, you know, I would buy a book, I'll give you an example, a book on Kajri, written in Hindi, called Kajri Mirjapur Sarnam, written by one Dr. Arjun Das Kesri, who lives in Roberts Ganj near Banaras. And the book cost me some, if I remember correctly, 20 rupees by VP. And when it came to me, it was this thin little book, very poorly printed.
How did you find out about it?
I had been reading about Kajri and people had cited that, but it was not available in any regular bookstore. Finally, I ordered it from him and it came, this tiny raggedy little book, but with the most amazing information on Kajri and Kajri Akhadas, and how people, who are heading Kajri Akhadas have actually used the form to even give social and political messages.
My God, yes.
So, yeah, there are people who have written Kajris about a whole group of men in a village turning towards alcoholism and the protesting of the women against that. There are others that were written during, you know, the independence movement. And so there are Kajris with a nationalistic flavor to them. So, you know, I mean, there is such wonderful material which is available across the country and probably in every nook and cranny that you wish to look into, that it seems such a pity that all of this material was not easily accessible to students of music like us and younger people, that we felt that without any experience of turning into entrepreneurs, we felt that now was the time, with the internet coming in and technology changing, we felt that this was a time for empowerment, and we felt that we must jump at this opportunity. And we established _records, which is merely a distribution platform, and we tried to do all the things. We tried to sort of make it a platform that was friendly for artists. So if material of this nature needs to reach people, why have any proprietorial hold over it? So we felt that if I can't promise the author that I will have this book, I will make this book available in every part of the world, then why do I need world rights for it? And if it's such a, you know, wonderful book, why should other booksellers not be able to sell it? So all of these things, we felt it's more important for the musician, producer, author writing about Indian music and different aspects of Indian music, not only classical. We felt it was necessary to have this friendly platform, democratic platform, where we dispensed with the formalities of the pandit and ustad, and, you know, everybody is the same there. Even my guru, whose CD we first distributed is called by his name, Ramashray Jha, and not Pandit Ramashray Jha. The idea was to give the same amount of space for each bio, for each album cover, so that there are no hierarchies.
No problem,
it did. It did, you know, there were a few eyebrows that were raised, and we explained that this is what we are trying to do. Please help us. And you know, Teesta, it's wonderful that some of the most, I would say, iconic names in Hindustani classical music blessed us in a sense, you know, by making their music available.
It's amazing what you have there.
Yes, for example, Ram Narayan Ji, his CDs from his private collection are available. And there are so many iconic, you know, Abdul Halim Jafar Khan Sahab, his music is available on our, on this site. And the wealth of the site is the goodwill that we enjoy with artists.
But your approach is very unique. No, you're not interested in the holding onto the material, you're just interested in disseminating it.
Yes, because I can't promise that I will get it across, you know, so a contract which says I own this material in worldwide, in perpetuity and in any other format that is developed in the future, I don't know whether I'll be around to enjoy that other format or not. Why on earth would I want to hold on to the rights? And I feel it's important for artists to start publishing themselves and distributing them their own work on their own terms and conditions, because in fact the music industry has stopped doing so.
You fought a case on this, if I'm not mistaken, for the creative rights of artists.
You know, the case of course is sub judice and has been going on for several years, and the cases that I've been involved in are to do with copyright and the very complex issue of copyrights. So I haven't really fought a case for anybody else's rights because I don't have the authority to do so. However, what we have done is that in the past we've tried to create, you know, or work with people who are ready to support a platform where issues of copyright, etc., can be discussed in a friendly way and not in court. We don't want to become a litigious community. But at the same time, we would like our colleagues to be aware of issues which are being faced by artists today. And so we've tried to, you know, for example, there have been seminars and workshops, and we've asked lawyers to answer questions. So get three lawyers to answer the same question spoken in layman's language. So for example, if I'm being asked to, I'm invited for a performance, do I have the right to say that it will not be recorded on audio video format? Now every artist understands this. Yeah, so, and the answer to that and how it is answered by different very skilled legal experts, we try and share that material. We have on underscore a downloadable contract template which anybody can use and customize. So we've done those small things, but of course a lot remains to be done.
You know, the one of the interests that you've shown is that why we don't put enough energy and effort in teaching Hindustani music in our schools,
yes,
in our classrooms. What more do you think we should be doing in that direction?
You know, it's not the issues that I addressed were not about Hindustani music.
Any music.
I feel there is no arts education program, and it's not one that is, you know, I would like children in India to be exposed to the arts as fortunately I was. And nobody told me, for example, that turn off the radio because there's a song from a film that is playing. I was allowed to listen to everything, and there were strong opinions and preferences, and we, you know, fought with everybody and argued and debated why we liked a certain kind of music and why we didn't like a certain kind of music that our parents were listening to, for example. But there was that articulation, there was a reason that was given, and there was a sharing. And I feel everybody is entitled to their musical preferences, and I would like that diversity, which is so much a part, that plurality, which is so much a part of our existence, should also be displayed in the arts, and a healthy sort of enjoyment of that diversity and plurality. So I'm not of the opinion that Hindustani classical music should be taught. I'm of the opinion that children should be given an arts education, a vibrant arts education program that lets them explore every kind of music available in India, which is a tall order.
Yeah.
But
at least give them a taste of what is
that
there.
Should be the intention. And of course, how to create the resources, how to create the curriculum, syllabi, those are complex issues and cannot be handled by a single person. Diverse opinions and suggestions must come into that. But there must be an exposure to the arts. There must be a sensitizing to the arts. Otherwise, we are going to see more brutality, more violence, more, tearing asunder of this kind of beautiful, kind of complex, composite fabric that once existed.
You think that the absence of a certain spirituality which comes from the arts breeds violence?
I think certainly a sensitization to the arts, because finally, tell me one thing, however much, and fortunately we are still able to see this, however much you may try and create polarizations, when you hear a voice and it touches your heart, you can't help it. You or whoever, from whichever community, from whichever geographical, political, background, it doesn't matter. You want to hear that. And I think perhaps
infusion creating, of that.
Yeah, might perhaps
bring some sanity back.
I hope so.
Shubha bought her first Tanpura as a radio broadcaster, earning money as a radio broadcaster. That's what I just learned today. And
yes.
You said you love the radio very much. And
yes, I loved radio. And when I was in college, I mean school and college, I started working occasionally as a casual announcer on All India Radio. And I used to get
that must be available somewhere.
I wonder. But I remember that the first check that I received, I thought I was the richest person in the world. I think it was for some 500 rupees or something, but it meant the world to me. And I finally bought my first Tanpura with those checks that came in. Of course, I'm sure my parents must have put in a generous contribution towards getting it from Miraj in Maharashtra.
That's the best place to get it.
Yes, yes. But yes, that's how I remember starting to work on All India Radio.
You know, while I was preparing for this interaction and I was listening to one of your most favorite podcasts on your, one of your podcasts on your underscore North, it's the one which tells you about the first recording of Gohar Jahan.
Of Kesar Bhai.
The Kesar Bhai is also there.
And
but
then
Gohar Jahan in 1902.
Yes, 02, yeah.
And this particular thing really struck me because I've heard it a couple of times, is that when she visited Faizabad,
yes.
And in this mission school, they encountered a BB who she predicted would become Begum Akhtar.
Yeah.
And then I suddenly remembered that, you know, the kind of unsung, lonely death that Begum Akhtar died.
Yes.
I mean, what does that tell you about the life of a musician, a singer in our world, in our times?
Well, you know, last year we celebrated Begum Akhtar's centenary. But unfortunately, I mean, of course, an iconic figure while she lived and while she sang. It was really, it was distressing for Anish and me to find that in Lucknow, her grave at Pasand Bagh was lying in absolute ruin and shambles. And that try as they might, people who loved her music, her disciples, music lovers of Lucknow, tried their best, and it was not through any government authority that the graves of Begum Akhtar and her mother were restored to the beautiful condition they are now in. But it actually was, you know, Madhvi Kukreja from Sanat Kada, Salim Kidwai, and other friends, Shanti Hirananji, Begum Akhtar's disciple. All of these people actually rallied for this. They had to actually knock at many doors to restore the grave of this iconic singer. And I felt a sense of not just distress, but, you know, extreme guilt and shame that we did not contribute. I feel, you know, sometimes that I feel like a coward, Teesta, and in front of you I certainly feel like a coward.
No, you're not a coward. I'm just going to resist the resistance you put up on so many occasions.
No, really, because it's fine to come out and sing on one evening. I mean, I do that every day. So if I don't do it at home and I do it somewhere else, it's no big deal. But I do feel that a certain amount of active participation and contribution, more than just this idea of doing a hazri at senior musicians' Astana or grave or, you know, Samadhi or whatever you want to call it. But I feel that we should have contributed. Musicians, students of music, we should have contributed. And even now I'm told that a small sum is required to finish the project. But I'm really surprised that everybody, I don't know why. I mean, I know that there would be many musicians who would want to come forward. But I don't know why everybody balks at actually starting that whole, process. Yes, I will ask Madhuri because I feel they have done enough and we shouldn't sort of just jump in at the last moment.
You, since you brought it up yourself, the business of cowardice and thing, I just want to say in 1991, at the age of 32, I think you sang at the first Safdar Hashmi Memorial platform, on that platform, the SAHMAT platform. And then you went all over the country in the Anhad Garje shows. It was a difficult time in India.
Yes.
What made you do that? Why did you feel the need as a musician, as a composer, to do it?
Well, I'll tell you. You know, I came from a sort of sheltered space. You know, in Allahabad, I was the sort of loved daughter of colleagues. You know. And of course, my parents had strong political opinions as well, but were not aligned with any political party at all, despite what many of the right-wing websites say. But really speaking, I had lived a fairly sheltered life, and for me, the pursuit of music was about getting my tans to zip up and down the saptak of a rag, and were about showing people that I knew so many compositions, I could sing this rag, and that I was tutored by some of the finest musicians, etc. But you know, when S. Kalidas and Sabina Sehgal asked me for the first time to come to a Sehmat concert entitled Artists Against Communalism, I had no idea what I was going in for. And the sight and sound and the vibes of that first experience, I was standing there surrounded by hundreds of people, holding my tanpura in one arm, crooked in one arm. And in front of me was this stage, and I saw the most iconic musicians, dancers, theater people come and perform for 15 minutes each, no nakhra, no, diva like tantrums, nothing. And on the side, I looked and I couldn't, you know, I there was Hussain Saab, there was Ghulam Sheikh, there were all sorts of people who were just, you know, I had only read their names and perhaps seen their pictures. Each, they were painting the same canvas, different parts of the same canvas. And that idea of this collective was so powerful and inspiring in a strangely unfamiliar way, that I was delighted to be a part of it. And of course, I didn't know what to sing. I only knew that 12:30 baje din mein mera turn aa raha hai, so I said, okay, Vrindavani Sarang. And I sang that. But then as I met more people who were involved with Sehmat, then as the Anhad Garje concert came up, I prepared, and you know, the 1st of January, symbolic in so many ways for artists and for what is, for all the beliefs that we hold, that are so precious for us, became a space for me which I looked forward to throughout the year. I wanted to prepare for it, as I prepared for singing, let's say, in a Malhar festival,
yeah,
or in a Bhairav ke Prakar festival. But the Sehmat concert was a space.
That's the day that Safdar was killed.
Yes, and I wanted to bring repertoire that was new to me, extend my repertoire, my training in Hindustani classical music, to try and see what I could sing. And it was exciting. It artistically, it was very exciting. So people would come, and if somebody would give me Kabir verses, the other would give me Ibn Insha, somebody would give me Habib Jalib's work, somebody would give me Dushyant Kumar's work, and actually set me in a direction which really has been a very special space for me.
And remains until today.
Absolutely. And I don't get to, this is not the repertoire that, you know, people call me for, but it's a very precious space in my journey. And I really cherish that, and I feel greatly enriched by that experience.
I still remember in November 2011, one call when I was with Rajendra Prasad of Sehmat, one call to you, and I requested you to come for the Gulberg Memorial.
Oh, my God.
And you came and you sang from the terrace of a house where 19 people had been killed out in the open at 8 o'clock in the night. It was amazingly soothing for all the survivors who were there. What did you take back from that concert?
You know, for me, it was a very difficult concert because, of course, as I've said, it's very easy for me to commit to being present at a space which is remembering something terrible that had happened.
But your choice of what you sang, everything.
You know, I don't know how to explain it to you, but nothing prepared me for actually being there. I'd seen pictures, I'd read so much, I'd seen not just still pictures, but documentaries, television, everything seemed familiar. And yet the reality of it was terrifying and traumatic for me in some ways. And the, how should I say, the just sitting there, I felt I could do nothing. I couldn't really make any, you know, explanations about why I was there. I only knew that if at all I wanted to make a sound, it was through the music and through the powerful words of people who had so eloquently and at times satirically talked of other similar times when humanity has lost control over any sense of justice, any sense of, so it was a difficult concert, Teesta, but the fact that there were survivors there and you were sitting there and across the country other
but
artists
also, yeah, also
I think that really gives you the strength to sit there and not break down and howl as you would want
yeah,
to.
Yeah, yeah.
Really. So that was,
you know,
very
that brings
special.
Me to a slightly wider question of, you know, music and resistance, music and protest, and music and conflict. You know, there's such a wide variety on the podcast that one saw, and you were mentioning Kesarbhai when I mentioned Gaur Jahan, and there was also this wonderful one with Dr. Ashok Ranade talking
yes.
about the Bagish, the rag, you know,
yes.
and also the Deepavali one that you've
yeah.
done. I just wondered, and a question occurred to me because I was preparing, is that would Hindustani music, which is your genre, would there be special moments and times that have recorded conflict? For instance, would there be certain times of period? I mean, it could have been partition, it could have been, you know, 1984, it could have been 2002. I just wondered whether there have been any such phases. I mean, partition, we know of the literature, we know of the poetry, but have there been certain such things, particular music compositions coming out?
Well, not specifically,
yeah.
but of course, the very idea of setting up, let's say, institutions to teach Hindustani classical music, sort of democratizing the space which was available only to Khandani musicians, to hereditary families of musicians. They were the custodians of this great knowledge for a long time. I think that the setting up of institutions, the inclusion of, let's say, people like Vishnu Digambar Paluskar and Bhatkhande in various, they often sang, for
by
example.
By the national leadership
after
independence.
Yeah, in fact, Paluskar even sent one of his disciples to Sabarmati Ashram to compose the bhajans that Mahatma Gandhi liked so much. Similarly, other people also got involved in this idea of creating a nation which really celebrated its heritage. Now, there are complexities even in those stances and narratives that they took. But nevertheless, and there were, of course, compositions too, which were created. For example, I remember Ratan Jankarji, who was heading the Marist College in Lucknow.
Okay.
He had made several compositions, which were, let's say, a composition in Rag Yaman, which was Jai Jai Bharat Desh Mahan. So about a new nation emerging, full of hope and idealism. And of course, these were possibly meant to be taught to students and presented by students. So there were these kind of repertoires also that slowly emerged. There were others that were not so specific. So earlier Braj Bhasha and Avadhi were the preferred yes, and in which a lot of writing, the sahitya for all these compositions comes from there. But then other composers, for example, Govind Narayan Natu, started writing in Khadi Boli and created many beautiful compositions, very wordy. as Khadi Boli often can be, but he created compositions, very exquisite ones, in Rag Bhatiyar, in Yaman, many. There's an entire compilation of his compositions. So that happened.
Okay.
Also, as I mentioned earlier, there's this beautiful book by Amritlal Nagar. It's called Ye Kothe Walia. And it's one of the most informative books on courtesan culture. Yes. And he mentions that he met Vidyadhari Bai of Banaras. And she was already in her 80s. And she describes this meeting, which was addressed by Mahatma Gandhi, and which was a meeting of the Tawaifs of those times.
Wow.
And was presided over by the Chaudhrayan at that time.
And Gandhi is meeting them. Huh?
Yes.
Gandhiji is meeting them.
Gandhiji is meeting them, and he's also encouraging them to get their children to get a good education and perhaps not take up the same profession, because there is that sense of
moral.
But he asks the women to also include in their repertoire a song of protest.
Yes,
because he says that you travel to many places and you actually perform for such important, powerful people. So sing Thumri Dadra, sing what you sing, but also include one song of protest.
That's incredible.
Yeah, and then Vidyadhari Bai writes, when Anagar asks her, can you remember anything? She says, not right away, but then she sent him an England letter form with a song written in it, and she says, this is one song that I remember, and he has published that in his book. So that's one of the incidents that we've also dramatized. We asked Sunil Shanbag to dramatize for our for a production called Stories in a Song. So Vidyadhari Bai's use of that song, Chun Chun ke phool le lo arman rehna jaye ye hind ka bagicha gulzar rehna jaye.
So there is that. There's always been that subterranean. Yeah.
Yeah, and I'm sure that in other regional languages,
you'll find the same thing. You know, we've come to a stage today where we are seeing splurge of these, like a snowballing of these writers' protests.
Yes.
You know, it began actually with Uday Prakash a few months ago. Then Nayantara Sehgal has just got sort of set the ball. Shashi Deshpande set the ball. What do you feel about these protests?
I think it's wonderful that they decided to state their protest. And I know that there has been a lot of noise and very, very uncivilized debates with them, where their motive has been questioned. Why didn't you do this earlier? I think this question is ridiculous. I think that they did it, that they chose the moment where they felt the need to do so. And I think they've been true to their artistic urges. I see no reason why they should be questioned about why they didn't do so earlier. And in any case, they are going on saying, for example, one of the questions that I heard on a debate last night was about why didn't you protest when Dabolkar was killed? Because that was in the previous regime. But they are saying that a pattern is emerging, and that pattern becomes clear only with repeated incidents like that. I mean, how... I cannot understand a question of this nature. At the same time, I also respect a Mridula Garg who protests but has not given up her award.
Everyone does it in their own way.
I feel this is the way, this is the kind of way, this really is what should be happening, that people who do not want to give it up or want to do so at a later stage or not at all, why should their motives be questioned also? And so I think, this kind of, this is an intolerant time that we are living in. And it shows up in the smallest ways and in the most violent ways. The very fact that you're questioning these people about why they did not do so earlier and saying their past should be and their backgrounds should be investigated.
Ganesh Devi had the State IB Intelligence Bureau visiting him in Tejgar.
So, I mean, this is crazy, and I think... every time something like this happens, and every time a writer says that, I think it's very good, and I think it's exemplary.
I think you also were part of a delegation that went to the former home minister when, on Hussein Saab's exile.
Yes.
And what was the sort of response you got?
A very curt response.
That was also a SAHMAT delegation,
I think. It was. I think Ram was with us, and Rajan, Ram Rahman and Rajan went. And there, you know, they wanted us to follow. They felt, what is the need for this, for you to come here? Why are you questioning our motives? Have you filed an FIR? What makes you feel that he is in some danger? So, I mean, how do you prove that he is in danger? When he's chopped up in pieces then? And then you say, why didn't you do this and why didn't you do that when he was chopped? I mean, there were people calling for his hands to be chopped off. And that was being done in the internet. Surely there must have been IP addresses to those websites. We need to become investigators to really find that out?
Do you feel threatened physically as an artist when you take such a radical stand today? I mean, there was that one incident in the United States when one of the members of the people who had invited you to the temple to perform. You remember in California?
They didn't invite me. They were merely people who had hired the venue
I see, organizers. I see.
And in my contract, actually, it said that the concert would take place at the Santa Clara Convention Center. It was only when I reached the U.S. that I realized that the location, the venue had changed.
Back then, there was a physical threat. Do you feel threatened to you?
To be honest, I would be a coward to say that no, I did not feel any sense of fear. Of course, when you live a civilized life, people just barging in and trying to, you know, create a ruckus are not something that you would not be afraid of. But I also did not feel, you know, I think I also felt very affronted that I should be called anti-Hindu and anti-national. You know,
it's a complete usurpation of the term, you know.
Yeah. That incident, again, I'm glad you brought it up, because I don't feel at all, you know, a sense of heroism about that incident. It was an ugly incident. It was not something that I would, you know, that I would say, oh, nothing happened. I didn't. No, it was a very ugly incident. And it happened half an hour before I went on stage. That is not the frame of mind But I was with artists who were very supportive. I was singing a jugalbandi with the famous Carnatic vocalist Bombay Jayashree and two of her wonderful accompanying musicians. Not a single one of them said that they would be willing to go on stage without me.
That's amazing.
That's so brave. And I think that's so supportive. And Jayashree ji was very, very firm. We will go on stage together or not at all. And I think it's lovely to feel that sense of support. However, I also feel that, you know, a lot of people use that incident to bring up other issues. And I think that's unfortunate too. I mean, somebody started a petition to talk about removing this person who came and threatened me from the temple. I mean, look, if you feel he is not competent, do it yourself.
Yeah, by using
this incident. And so I think, you know, we need, if we ask for tolerance, then we must also be not manipulating situations to political or to our advantage. I think that's also necessary.
In these very, very dark times that we live in, and we always believe, like Breck said, that during the dark times, they will be singing about the dark times.
Yeah.
So will we see a special Shubha composition about the dark times?
You know, it's strange that you brought this up. About 2 years ago, Anish and I were feeling particularly depressed after one of these many incidents of brutality, intolerance, etc. were occurring. And then we happened to read a few lines by Sahir Ludhianvi. And I'm going to sing those to you. Just a few lines, because I love those.
Please.
Sahir Saab says, Aao ke koi khab bune kal ke vaaste. Aao ke koi khab bune kal ke vaaste. Varna ye raat aaj ke sangeen daur ki das legi jaan o dil ko कुछ ऐसे के जानो दिल ताउम्र फिर न कोई हसी ख्वाब बुन सके आओ के कोई ख्वाब बुने कल के वास्ते.
There really is nothing more to be said.
Really.
Thank you so much for
Thank you, Teesta.